the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Before the liturgy and the proscomedia, the priest, when he begins, says, Thou hast redeemed us from the curse of the law by thy precious blood, having been nailed to the cross and pierced with the spear. Thou hast gushed forth immortality upon mankind, our Savior, glory to thee. We've been redeemed from that curse, which is the cross that we're bearing, which is that tree that led to us to our destruction in Eden when we ate the fruit out of disobedience and pride. By Christ's shedding of blood, by his acceptance of the cross, that instrument of death, that instrument of torture, which was the most horrible thing in the ancient world. Of course, if it was being done now, in some places it is, we'd be horrified even today. This most derisive form of death has now become our life, has become grace for us, has become a blessing. We've been redeemed from the curse of the law by that very instrument of death and by that very horrible weapon of torture which frightened the world. We see throughout history that people feared this, but the Christians embraced it. The Christians ran to it, as a matter of fact. In many cases, I think of one of the new martyrs of the Turkish yoke, another Cyprian, who ran to the scaffolding ahead of his persecutors that he could die and be with Christ ahead of them, to their amazement. Last night in the Old Testament readings, the first one we had was about the Hebrew people, of course, complaining they didn't have water they wanted, so they go to this pool at Marah, and Moses takes this tree and puts it into the waters, and the waters that were bitter now became sweet and drinkable. And that is indeed what the Father sees in the cross, is that the cross comes into the difficulties of our world and the trials of this world and makes those bitter waters bearable and sweet. The sufferings seem to come for our salvation and become glorious. Of course, the Hebrew people weren't satisfied. They complained for food, and he gave it to them. They complained again for water, and Moses strikes a rock and brings it out with a stick, by the way. Another tree showing us salvation, another type of the cross. But they continually complain, and because of this complaining and disbelief, they do not enter into the promised land. And a couple of them get to enter from that group that wandered for so many years. But that is our path to salvation, to embrace these things without complaint, with glory, with acceptance. That morning prayer of the Octina Elders, which many of you know, the Lord grant that I may meet all this day brings to me with spiritual tranquility. Grant that I may accept all that comes to me from thy holy will, and on and on. Whatever news may reach me in the course of the day, should you accept with a calm soul and firm conviction that all is subject to thy holy will. So when we complain against God for our trials and the difficulties that we have in our life, are we not being as the Hebrew people, not accepting our cross and not having faith in God, that God knows what he's doing, that he loves us, that these very trials that we have were sent by God? Remember the words of Pilate, to Pilate, you would have no power over me except it was given you from above. And none of our sicknesses, none of our illnesses, none of our financial woes, none of our emotional strife, any of it, could not come to us unless it was given to us from above. God has allowed things to happen in our lives that are difficult, of course. But as Job, we must say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Whatever those trials are, if we bear them without complaint, unlike those Hebrew people, we can find much grace in whatever trials we've been given. Think about Father Seraphim Rose's life when he died the most horrible death from the terrible illness he had, the disease that he had. No one knew he had it until he ended up in the hospital because he did not complain one single time, but embraced what God had sent upon him. How the world would change if we would embrace our crosses. And for our own personal lives, think about it ourselves. If we would just accept, this is from God, this is God's sign of love for me. As St. Paisios says, every time we have a trial, we can see it as a sign of God's love in our life, whatever it may be, that God has chosen us. We heard that in Proverbs last night. He chastens his sons, whom he loves. We're not having those trials woe be to us. But we do have those trials. And because of those trials, they can become life-giving and life-bearing. If we but accept them and say, thanks be to God, God is working out my salvation. I might not understand what this is now. I might understand why I have to go through this, but it is just a brief blip in time, and it is gone. But if we accept that it is eternity with Christ and transfiguration, remember he announces his transfiguration after he announces his suffering. And after his transfiguration, not long thereafter, he reminds his disciples of his immediate suffering coming up. So there is, as St. Isaac the Syrian says, no one ever entered the kingdom of heaven with comfort. So with each and every one of us in this room, then I can look at every face and know some of your trials, because I do. And I know my own. But they are for our salvation and signs of God's love for us, as he showed us himself by embracing the cross of his own will, voluntarily taking upon the suffering, that these things no longer have power over us, but they can be used essentially as catapults into the kingdom of heaven. May God teach us to embrace his cross with joy, because it is through that cross that joy has come into all the world. Amen.